Hey guys, welcome to the Nick Bahe YouTube page. You know what you need to do. You need to subscribe, you need to ring the bell, you need to like the page, you need to leave a comment. I appreciate you. Oh, here we go. Here we go again, wine pod time. Shout out to Go Currency for making it happen. I'm seeing Go Currency everywhere. I mean, everywhere. I saw it on a TV commercial, a billboard, and they're getting their podcast game right for making the wine pod happen for us. We have cheated. We have cheated, everyone. We are already drinking this Italian wine. Hey, do you want to cheers now or what?
Cheers, but we will still pour some more in a second.
Of course we will. I will say this. I'm going to try hard. You cannot make me laugh really hard tonight. Because laughing, see, boy had the hernia surgery.
Didn't think about that.
I don't, you know, I can't laugh too hard. Okay. I really just no don't. Problem. So don't be funny. Don't do anything to make me laugh.
We're going to keep it, unfunny all night.
I will say that was one of the most aware. So I went, it was outpatient. So I, you know, like I went in, I think I went under the knife at 7:30 and I was home by like 11:30 or something like that. Yeah. But that was the most alert I had been. I've had a couple of surgeries. The most alert I'd been, like, I was awake when they put me onto the operating table. And they said, they're like, oh, so we're starting the medicine? Okay. And then I felt my anesthesia's creepy. I felt my head get really warm. And then it was lights out.
I kind of wish every night at bed you could have that.
You could just go, we ready? We're going out. But I've never felt, I've gone under before. Yeah. I've never felt that, like, that warm. It was the last memory I have is like, ooh, warm head, lights out.
You were probably thinking about it. You're like, I'm going to think about feels like.
Well, because you think, you're just like, okay, here it is. This is going to happen. Like, I am going to be out in a second.
Were you trying to fight it?
Not really. I just was kind of like, ugh. By the way, my anesthesiologist, Jim Clements, former Lincoln Southeast quarterback. How about that?
Oh, yeah. No, I've seen Jim at the hospital.
Yeah, so I bet you have. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
So I had no idea. So at 6 o'clock in the morning, in walks Jim Clements. He's like, so this is what happens to Southeast quarterbacks. And I'm like, wow.
That's
small world
that's
there.
Unbelievable.
But yeah, so we'll see. I'm week out, so I'm not like incapacitated. Like, we couldn't have done this last week, obviously. No,
couldn't do it.
Laughing.
Random question. Are you a quick to go out sleeper normally? Like, are you a person when you lay down in bed, can you go to bed? Like, can you shut your eyes and go to sleep? Or does it take you 10, 20, 30 minutes of like.
I would say more often than not, I'm quick.
You're quick.
Yes. I'm not one of those guys that. I would, one of the worst feelings is when you're laying there and you're creeping up to that, like, it's been 20 minutes. It's been 30 minutes.
I'm kind of a 10, 20, 30 minutes of like, it takes me to go. And my wife, like when she lays down, if it's
over,
if it's a minute. So I think it's weird. I've heard so many people talk about this where husbands and wives get like resentful to the one that can sleep.
Yeah.
And I'm such a fan of sleep. I'm like, no, this is good. I'm happy for you. But like other people get pissed off. They're like, your husband can be like, well, time to sleep. And it's the people that
it's a bad feeling when you have been fighting for 20 minutes and then your wife comes in and falls asleep before you. That's like a really, you're like, you just feel like you got crossed up in bed.
You know what I mean? And it's dunked on.
Dunked on you in bed, which is a bad deal. But no, I can feel, I remember for like, I went off coffee for like a week, a handful of years ago. And that was, I couldn't believe now, cause I am like a multiple cups in the morning and an afternoon coffee guy every day.
Yeah.
And I couldn't believe going off of coffee, how fucking tired you are. Like when 8 o'clock hits, I mean, you are exhausted and ready to shut her down. But I was going to say like, I do subscribe to the school of thought of like your bedtime routine, like what you do leading up to that time of like, okay, I'm shutting it down. Like if you're on your phone scrolling and stuff like that, then it's hard to shut your brain off.
Well, see, I'm no phones.
Oh, you do that hardcore?
Oh yeah. I mean, I got on my phone where at, I think it's 8 o'clock. I can't see if texts come in. So like pretty much if,
look at you.
I don't exist past 8 p.m. So like, no, like I'm a big believer, like you want to keep the lights low,
right?
Like no bright lights.
Yep.
So I'm a big fan of like no text, no screens.
I didn't know that.
I'm reading my book.
So text Bo Ruud post 8 o'clock. It might not happen.
No, I mean, I may see it if I have to like set an alarm or something, I re-enter the phone to do it. But like most of the time, like that phone's off and I'm not looking at it.
You know what's kind of sad is I used to, as a basketball player, when I would close my eyes, I would daydream about basketball. Like I would think about basketball. Mm-hmm. I'd put myself in a game and I would think about like, I'm gonna start. I'm gonna come off this flare screen. I'm gonna hit that shot. Like, and then like you play a game in your head.
Yeah.
And I found like once I was done with basketball, like it honestly almost feels silly to do that in some ways.
I always, Nick, I'm not lying to you. Most nights I daydream about something, whether it's a work scenario that's gonna happen with work, or like I'll just think through
arguments with people.
I like thinking through like fun scenarios like that, but I do that all the time.
I love it. Okay, so we got the wine going.
Tell me your songs like Dreamweaver.
Well, here, okay, so we're doing the song of the day. Let's get these bad boys on, dog.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's get these on. The song of the day. You know,
and it is time for the opening pour. So I'm gonna pour a little more.
I feel like you're ahead of me at this point. All right, let's pull this
wine is tasting amazing.
It's good, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so
let me get you.
Yeah, hook me up. Oh yeah.
Let's get you a real.
Oh, you trying to do your boy dirty, dog?
Oh, son.
We got a lot of things to get in tonight. Okay. So song tonight came on randomly. I just put my music on shuffle. And I was just like cleaning the house and it came on and I was like, well, I haven't heard this song in a long time. Okay. I don't even know how else to set it up other than I want to play it. And then we'll just kind of get into what this song, where my brain went when I heard this song after I hadn't heard it in a while. Obviously everyone's going to know this. Okay.
Bum, 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 bum,
Bone Thugs in Harmony. The Crossroads. I don't know I hadn't heard this song in a long time. And
how many times did we watch the video?
Well, the other thing that I wrote down, do you remember? This was the first song I ever recorded off of the radio onto a tape. And you and I, in my living room when we were 10 years old, would put in the tape and we'd listen to this song. But we saw this video a million times.
I would come over after school and it'd be that it was on MTV's yes. like countdown, I think from like 4 o'clock on or something. And it was like number one, you know, however many times, but we would wait for that moment.
This song was huge.
They're walking up the mountain. And it's yes. Easy. I mean, oh yeah.
So a couple of things I was thinking about. This song, you've heard the song a million times. You think you know the words. If you Google the lyrics, you aren't even close. You're so far off.
So follow me. I have no idea what that
is. I don't know.
So follow me, Roadstro.
I say Sco. And what would Sco be? But you look up the lyrics.
What's that lyric? That one right there. Follow
I
me,
don't
road.
Know. Let's pull it up here.
Sco.
Crossroads, yeah, no. I'm telling you, it is. This might be the ultimate, like, hilarious. How bad you are butchering the.
We used to sing this.
Yes, we did.
I think we were preparing for a talent show, and we were going to lip sing this in the talent show. And we never did.
We never happened.
Thank God.
Why'd they kill my dog? Eazy-E.
Yeah.
And then, man, I miss my Uncle Charles, y'all. I mean, anybody that's got Uncle Charles, that really hit home. But Now follow me. I'm trying to look it up. I don't know what it. I think it's follow the Lord. Oh,
follow the Lord.
I think so. Follow the Lord all 24/7. I'm telling you, you look at it. You're like, I don't know how they do this. Cause you look at it and you're like, how are they rhyming it and making it work? But they're making it work. It's incredible.
They can go fast.
Oh, so, okay. So I wrote that down of first song ever recorded off the radio.
Yeah.
I think one of the things that kids these days just have no, like having access to any song ever instantly is mind blowing.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think, because we talked about having to go home and at 4 o'clock you knew like, okay, this, if I want to hear Bone Thugs in Harmony today,
it takes work.
Like, okay, it's 4 o'clock. I better get to wherever, and now I can listen to it. You know what I mean?
It's a different mindset of It's all at your fingertips. Every kid has everything at their fingertips, right?
Right.
And in the old days, it was like you would either, I mean, the farther you go back, the harder it was to get the song you wanted, right?
Right.
Especially if it wasn't like, if it was number one on top 40,
whatever,
you might get to hear it a lot. But otherwise, you just like, you'd be scanning the radio and just you're waiting at the mercy of the DJ.
Right.
Who's running the radio, or running the TV show or whatever. And it's just a different world. You had to like earn it or you had to tape it, like find a time to tape it and make it all
That's
work.
What I'm saying. I think I figured out because and there you go. There's a song today, Bone Thugs and Harmony, Crossroads. But that I think I figured it out on like back in the day, KFRX or whatever. You know, they'd have their like top eight at eight, I think it was.
Yeah.
And so you'd time it out, like the number one song would be at whatever, the 8:30. And I knew Bone Thugs would potentially be number one. And so I like waited for it and I recorded it.
And it was a big deal.
It was a big deal. And then the other thing we talk about the music videos, like the video itself in some ways was just important as the song. Because they were like, you couldn't separate the two. Because your only way to listen to music oftentimes was to watch the video. So they became synonymous with one another.
Okay, so we're going to have to talk more deeply about this book, hopefully in a week or two. So I just started reading the 90s.
The 90s, Chuck Klosterman. Yeah.
And, you know, he talks a lot about music videos.
Yeah.
You know, smells like Teen Spirit. Yep. Like that, the thing about the, like these music videos in the 80s and 90s was, it so shaped your mind of what the songs were. So like, think if you would have heard Smells Like Teen Spirit or Bone Thugs and never seen the video. Mo Money, Mo Problems.
Yeah, they're golfing.
You immediately see like the puffy suits floating. And
yeah.
Like, if you'd never see that, do you feel differently about the songs? I think you do.
Well, when I hear like, what is it? Blind Melon, No Rain. You instantly think of the girl in like the bumblebee suit.
The bumblebee suit.
You know, that don't necessarily have anything to do with the song.
Yes.
But yeah, it was hard to separate the two.
And that's the part I don't like.
You're trying to figure out what that influence on.
I know it does. It almost makes me, I wonder if like I like certain things less because the video made me just put it in a category or something instead of just being like, let me listen to music.
Well, they say now TikTok is really influencing music because, you know, it gets made there, you know, some songs got to have the beat to be able to put into a TikTok and whatever. Yeah. But like music videos had to have impacted music in some ways. I mean, I think just the image, especially being a hip hop guy, the images projected from hip hop were all there. I mean, it was women dancing, jewelry, cars, you know, though, like it was all those kind. Now, granted, those were in the lyrics of the songs oftentimes, but nevertheless, like the imagery of it was
a whole generation of kids. Like if you like, I always think about like even Irving Middle School, or like you go to your average middle school, high school, like there was a group of kids, call it 10 or 20%, that grew up watching like hip hop videos and they were going to dress that way.
Oh yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
yes.
And you're just like, that's what happened. There was a group of kids that was like, I watch grunge videos and that visual influences me. So they're wearing skater.
Yeah.
Grungy, like, you know, flannel and that whole thing because they saw Kurt Cobain wearing flannel. Like they see it and it changes the way that they are almost. It's bizarre.
Yeah. It's funny how I just don't even know necessarily now how what gets influenced in pop culture from a music standpoint without a music video.
I mean, they have music like videos. I just don't think people watch music videos.
Snoop in the early 90s with like he had flannels. So flannels became like a thing for like hip hop dudes to wear. Well, you know, Dre had his White Sox hat on.
Well, and they were all wearing the brown pants, wife beater.
Yeah.
Like, and like that's like comes from like prison culture.
Right.
Because prison culture was like that was a certain style. Hip hop took that style and like made it like a mainstream. So mainstream kids in Nebraska were
wearing
like,
that. Yeah.
Like, you know, quote unquote, like semi-prison style, like the influence of prison on gangster rap then influenced
Lincoln, Nebraska, Irving Middle School.
It's nuts to think about.
I know,
but that's how it works.
The other thing I wrote down, lots of songs and general content in the music industry about death in the 90s. Like, so both of Biggie's albums, Ready to Die, Life After Death, Crossroads, we just listened to, Tupac rapped about death all the time. Yeah. My girl Mariah Carey had the song with Boyz II Men, One Sweet Day, that was like a huge, it might have even won a Grammy, I think. With Puff, I'll Be Missing You, Gangsta Lean, Miss My Homies, Master P. Like, there was just a lot of, there was a lot of rapping about death.
Well, it was a weird time. I mean, now you don't see any of that because it's a different era. In that era, it was like, God, I mean, the '80s were way worse for gangs, but in the early '90s, like, gangs were a big deal. People were dying on the streets, and that's where a lot of the influence came from. And then the whole East Coast, West Coast thing real. It was a real
thing. The two biggest rappers in their prime both die in the '90s.
Got shot, assassinated.
And so that obviously is going to infiltrate it. But I was thinking, like, man, there's a lot of death talk in the,
because it was gang. I mean, it was gangster rap, and I think
at its height,
some
probably
of that was real, sort of like gangster culture, and some of it was like people wanted to live that life, and they sort of like started living that narrative almost.
Yeah,
where it's like people are dying and it's dangerous, but it's cool or something. Like, so it's such a weird moment to think about.
Yeah, I mean, even the poster behind Boys in the Hood, like that whole movie is very much like that was dealing with
that was reality in, I mean, that's South Central,
right?
And it's South Central. Yeah,
South Central LA. Yeah, yeah. Either they don't know, don't show, or don't care about what's going on in the hood.
That's right.
That's right. You know, Ricky was going to go to SC.
You know,
how would Ricky have been in Lincoln Riley's
Bill
system?
Bush,
probably pretty good.
Side note, Bill Bush recruited Ricky Thanars.
Was he from Compton?
He was from,
California, from LA, right?
In a rough part, and Bill Bush went and got him. Showed up. I guarantee, just like in the movie.
He's listed from LA, from Los Angeles, LA, California.
I know Ricky came from a tough area, but
I
always gave Bill Bush a lot of credit that he went in there. I mean, Bill Bush from Pinder, Nebraska, goes South to LA Central,
and pulls it. I love
it. It's Ricky.
See, I love it. I love it.
Yeah.
I love it. Speaking of coaching, like, candidates and stuff, I don't know how you were. Saturday, Husker bye week. My analogy I gave was, it was Frost has now been fired, and it's almost like you broke up with your longtime girlfriend, and it was your first time going out single. And so you went to the bar, you went to the club, and you were falling in love with everyone you saw. That was me Saturday watching college football with every head coach. Like, I was falling hard for Lance Leipold and falling hard for Chris Kleiman. And of course, falling hard for my guy, Dave Aranda, who went to Ames and waxed Matt Campbell's hiney.
Yeah.
Did you get to watch a lot of football? Did you try to like disengage?
I disengaged.
You needed a break.
Didn't watch a down of football on Saturday.
Sometimes you need like,
I don't know.
It's been a hectic 4 weeks.
I don't know how people out there that are listening felt, but to me, it was like, I just needed to not think about football for a weekend. Cause you know, it's been such a tumultuous couple of weeks that it wasn't like I just needed a Nebraska break. I just didn't want to think about anything. So I just took a day off and just was like, family day, had some fun. And I saw the text start coming in about the Martinez game.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, I'm not even going to do it.
I watched almost all of that game. But you're right. Like, to say that this has been tumultuous. Imagine when we were sitting here recording our preview podcast. If someone would have said, Nebraska is going to lose to Northwestern, Frost is going to kick an onside kick up 11, and it's going to be an atrocious decision, and that's going to be like almost like a spiral point. Then Nebraska is almost going to lose to North Dakota. Then they're going to lose to Georgia Southern. Frost is going to be fired. Then they're going to get run off the field by Oklahoma. Chenander is going to be fired. And then, oh, by the way, the next week, Martinez is going to dominate Oklahoma in prime time and come through in the clutch, not once, but twice in the fourth quarter. Like, literally, it is this season. Is like what I just described to you would be like, well, that'd be like laughable worst case scenario.
There's like scenarios, good, bad, like that's the worst case scenario.
Yes.
And we hit it like out of the park.
Yes. It's just, it's incredible that that's how it was so far through 4 weeks, but I can totally understand how you needed a break. I, for some reason, I think it was my hernia made it so like I had to sit and just like ice and chill. And like, I was excited to watch. I wanted to watch Kansas. I wanted to watch Leipold. I wanted to watch Aranda. I was excited to watch Martinez play Oklahoma. I wanted to, sometimes it's nice to take a peek around. Mm-hmm. And as I was thinking about this, like, I don't know if I'm falling victim to the hire the opposite of the last guy syndrome. You know, people can do that, like, or we even see it with relationships. Like, you want the opposite of your ex-girlfriend.
Yeah.
And like, cause right, Pelini was like mad and mean. So you hire Riley, who's like soft and nice, you know. I'm finding myself like, as I wrote this down, I wrote down ideal things I want on the resume from a coach. You know, it was like, I got like eight things down and it was like a distant last thing is offense. Like right now, I don't give a shit about a head coach's acumen offensively. And I don't know if I'm falling victim to that was Frost. He was the offensive guy. That didn't work. And so I want something completely different. Cause to me, it's like defense is like my number one thing that I want. I want a defensive oriented, defensive minded coach. I know I'm preaching to the choir.
I'm liking this, what you're talking about.
Here's what I wrote down. Defense. Midwest Big Ten experience and or fit. I do want someone that's been a head coach for a while that's got a little bit of a proven track record. Yeah. Recruiting. You got to write down recruiting, and I want to get into that. Either an elite national recruiter or a guy with Midwest ties that can, you know, develop and got an eye for talent. And then I wrote like distant fourth or fifth would be offense. Am I falling victim to?
I think you are. I actually think
hire the last guy.
I think
you're, or hire the opposite of the last guy.
A little bit victim to that. If I have to choose between an offense and defense coach, I'm just biased and would choose defense too. Like if I had to, but like I think it's less important whether they're an offensive or a defensive guy, and more important that they are going to be a good head coach, a good recruiter, and a good program builder. Like,
right.
Can they hire, like, if you're an offensive coach, can you hire the right defensive coach?
That's right. Yes. Because
I don't really care if you're a defensive coach or an offensive coach. Are you a good enough coach and evaluator of other coaches to know what the good opposite side of the ball looks like? Because like I feel like when I've seen coaches in person that are good at their side of the ball and they don't recognize what's wrong on the other side.
Right.
And that seemingly was part of Frost's, I think, issues. I don't think he was really this year. I don't think he thought about defense,
right.
You know, like, I don't think he was concerned about it. I don't think he was concerned about special teams most of his time here. Right. That's still part of the problem. Like the head coach is responsible for everything. So
right.
You got to know everything. Like and this is a bad example because nobody's this guy, but Bill Belichick knew it all.
Right.
So like, I got to watch a guy that like, he knew every coach, what they should be teaching and why. And if you didn't do that, he would either correct you or they need to find somebody else, you know, that can do that job. And that, so the standard is that obviously not everybody's that coach, but I guess my point is,
no, it's a good point.
I want the guy that knows how to build a program and evaluate not just players, but also coaches.
I think that's a great point. I would say, and again, I don't know if I'm prisoner of the moment with like extrapolating everything that Frost was associated with Frost and thinking that is like, I'm taking that too far. But I think it's easier. I'd rather have a head coach that is more like, I think it's easier to outsource the offense than it is to outsource the defense, in that if your head coach is an offensive guy, that just takes up more bandwidth of your mind then I think and maybe I'm shortchanging defense. Well, but like I think if you're a head coach and you're thinking about offense, or and you're the offensive, you're more offensive centric, you're that consumes more of you than if you're a defense.
Well, here's the kicker, right? So Pat Fitzgerald's a defensive coach. Does he call the plays for defense? No.
Yeah, I wouldn't think so.
Most of these offensive guru guys call the plays. Sucks up their work, like you say, it sucks up their mind. The defensive coaches don't usually coordinate the defense.
Right.
So I think there is that, I don't know what it is. It's the, like, I need control of the game that goes on the offensive side of the ball, where the defensive head coaches coach the whole team.
That's, I guess that, maybe that's what I'm getting at.
They aren't trying to call the defensive plays. They're coaching the team. They're thinking about, well, we need to, you know, let's keep the defense fresh. So we need to hold it. Like, they're more talking about strategy, where I think the offensive guys fall victim to, I'm going to call this killer game.
Yes.
My play calls are going to beat the defense. Like, they get victim to their play calling.
I totally agree. I just think most, outside of Tom Osborne, who is just almost a unicorn in that he was calling the plays, was an offensive guy, but had a great feel for the game. Mm-hmm. And somehow he was able to, like, compartmentalize, like, what was going on offensively with the game, with the defense, with who's in, with feel. We don't want to go for it here. This is a time to maybe dial up a trick play. This is time to, like, whatever. And I just think and you said it a lot more eloquently than me, that I just think defensive guys, I like how they're able to see the whole picture better.
Yeah, they're not focusing on this. They're focusing on,
they're zoomed out.
Zooming out, and they are saying, okay, how are we gonna win this game, like, holistically?
Yes.
On the whole. So you brought up Osborne. Osborne had a system that lent to, like, he can call plays, but they're going to be 90% run plays.
Yeah.
Run and play action, and only throw, like, drop back passes if you absolutely have to. But, like, it was run clock. It was wear them down in the fourth quarter. We get stronger at the end of the day, and they're going to get worn out, and we'll win the game in the fourth. Like,
right.
That was the mindset for decades. And, you know, run the ball and defense was part of that strategy. So he didn't have to, you know, game to game, pull it. And really, like, it was just like, this is what we do. And so he got really good at knowing how to do that.
Yes. And so I keep going back to where, like, I like Dave Aranda in that way. I think he checks a lot of those boxes, but you brought up recruiting. I wanted to get into this because we talked about it. I referenced the Sean Callahan nugget I saw in Big Red Wrap Up. You know, people always point to, when they talk about Nebraska, it's recruiting issues. It's got the fewest four and five star recruits in the 500 mile radius of any Power Five job in the country. Urban Meyer, I read a quote from him. He was asked about the Nebraska job. He says, this is Urban Meyer's quote. He goes, quote, You have to ask why they struggle today. And my answer is the recruiting base. Nebraska is an elite job. Nebraska has got historically one of the winningest programs, a great fan base. They've been down. They have to figure out this recruiting piece. They have to get someone who understands that area. So, but everybody talks about how hard it is to recruit here and all the recruiting issues here. So chew on this. I went back through on 24/7's composite recruiting rankings, okay? And I get it. You can roll your eyes at recruiting rankings. It's gotten to where it's a big industry. More often than not, they're right than that. Sure, Amir Abdullah is a three-star, and he was amazing. But for every one example of that, I'll show you a billion three-stars who were three-stars, you know? But chew on this. Going back to 2011... So that was Nebraska's first year in the Big Ten. So I'm going back 11 recruiting classes. Nebraska has had the number one ranked recruiting class in the Big Ten West every year except 2014. And I'd imagine the Bo Pelini turmoil impacted that.
Yeah.
And then here is where Nebraska's recruiting rankings, class rankings, stack up in the Big Ten. So this is just in the Big Ten. I'm focusing there. 2011, second in the Big Ten. 2012, fourth, 13, third, 14, sixth, 15, fourth, 16, fifth, 17, fifth, 18, fourth, 19, fourth, 20, fourth, 21, fifth, which spits out to an average of fourth. So the average recruiting class ranking has been fourth in the Big Ten. Keep in mind, you're recruiting, like, you're behind behemoths like Ohio State, Michigan, Penn State, where, let's be honest, like, I don't know if Nebraska's ever going to be able to out-recruit those teams.
Michigan and Ohio State are going to be really hard.
Oh, Penn State, maybe.
Penn State's they're like us in a lot of ways.
Right.
Here's what I'd love to see, and I don't have these stats. I don't know if anybody does. I would love to see, like, our high-ranked recruits. What's the hit rate on those?
Well,
like,
yes. Okay,
what's the hit rate on, like, the guys that actually end up being good players that are our high recruits? I have a suspicion that we are getting, like, the low end of the performance side of, like, these four-star
guys. Yeah.
High threes or whatever. Like, I just feel like, man, every good recruit we get, I just don't feel like it's like, and that guy's good now. It's like,
I know,
it's
because,
like,
well, because
that
that's
guy
what,
goes or this guy sucks. Or
well, because that's the thing, is you hear those things. And yet I feel like one of the things we've talked about is I felt like for a while there's been a talent issue. Like, well, I'm not seeing difference makers, but, like, according to the recruiting rankings, Nebraska's got the most talent in the Big Ten West. But here's where I think this was fascinating. Max Olson of The Athletic wrote about this, and this is really interesting. I'm just going to read. It's three paragraphs from the story.
Yeah.
During the Frost era, Nebraska has lost 56 scholarship players to the transfer portal, second most in the Big Ten. But here's the real issue. 40 of those departures came from the players in the staff's first three recruiting classes. Among those 56 scholarship players who transferred out, 45 stayed in the program for 2 years or less. 19 were gone by the end of their first year in the program. Just as troubling was how many of these signees failed to make an on-field impact at Nebraska. Of the 56 transfers, 43 played less than 100 career snaps on offense or defense for the Huskers, according to data from Pro Football Focus. There were 19 who played zero snaps. So for me, I guess this is where I'm just throwing this out there and trying to figure this out, because there's been this recruiting topic that people throw out there. I think maybe the recruiting base thing is overblown. Nebraska is able to get people here. Their problem has been retention and development.
I think it might be evaluation.
And evaluation.
I think it's evaluation and retention. Like, I mean, obviously, if you're losing guys, that's bad. But maybe, like, the guys they're losing, they're like, good, get out of here, too. Because, Nick, I don't know. I mean, we got, remember that, I think the one signing class to me tells me the story. Like, right now, let's be honest, our secondary has not been good.
No.
I mean, that's a fair statement.
And that's not being, like,
I'm not being
overly
mean.
Critical or mean. No.
They have not been good.
Right.
And if you look at the top recruits we've gotten in the last 3 years, none of them are either here or playing. You know what I'm saying?
Like, yeah.
Like, none of them. Like, remember those Miami guys that came in and they were here, like, they had a cup of coffee and
they were gone.
And, like, that's the type of stuff that, to me,
totally agree.
We whiffed on for years where we were trying to get these people that didn't want to come here. Like, we need to recruit, like, solid dudes that want to be here.
Yes.
More than, like, we were chasing stars and we were chasing, like, ratings. And we got the ratings and we didn't get the real talent or the program building players. I think we whiffed on all of that for years. For years we did.
Yeah, because I think it's about talent evaluation, development, and retention.
Yeah.
And a part of that talent evaluation is what you're talking about, is finding the right people that fit in Lincoln and are actually going to stick in Lincoln.
Yeah, I mean,
because you cannot have that kind of, because I think it's a bunch of different things working against Nebraska. So So maybe I'm talking out of both sides. This is where the 500 mile radius gets tricky, because you're having to pluck guys from outside of the radius. So sometimes it's a culture shock when you're outside of that 500 mile radius, which probably increases the chances that they get here. They go, oh crap, I don't like it here, I leave. But at the same time, I just think you're, I also think there's a part of your culture that can be built to handle that.
And I also think it's your job as the coach and recruiter, like,
figure that out on the front end.
You don't bring them, if they're a flight risk, if they're a guy that's like, I don't know if they're going to stay or not, then you can't take them. Like, right. You take the guy that is maybe not as highly rated, but they're like, I'm dying to be in Nebraska and I'm going to stick it out. Like, you got to go with those guys right now over these guys we can't count on. Like, to me, it's like, can you count on them? And if the answer is, I'm not sure, that's a no.
Right.
And we've been going with the, like, let's go with that I'm not sure guy that's got a nice 4-star.
Right.
And he's not the guy. That's not who we can build.
Because you cannot survive with that kind of attrition and losing that many players.
Yeah.
So that's what's hard about it. It's misleading. You see those recruiting rankings. It's like, well, these classes are getting decimated by players leaving. And so I think it's a combination of talent evaluation on fit for when they get to Lincoln. But then I also think, because what I went back is this spans back to 2011. You know what else kills attrition? 3 head coaches in 11 seasons. Yeah. Nebraska's had 3 head coaches. And then on top of that, you're dealing with turmoil of, like, Bo's on the hot seat for 2 years. Riley was a dead man walking. Frost has been on the hot seat for over a year. Like, so it's a bunch of these things that work against it. But I think it's interesting that you're able to get the guys here from a talent standpoint.
I think it's from a rating standpoint.
Right.
I don't know that it's a talent standpoint.
Because that's what's funny.
I think we're getting guys that are highly rated at times. But I'm not seeing the, like the difference between a 2-star and a 4-star sometimes is, like, it's non-existent when they actually get here. And that's the problem, is, like, I want the 4-stars that we get. They should be noticeably different.
I have never
not.
I mean, Nebraska's out-recruited Minnesota. I'm just using them as an example. But when I watch Minnesota and Nebraska play, I do not see the discrepancy that the recruiting rankings would tell you it is.
No.
I just, like, one of the things about this year in particular is, man, Nebraska, this team is, like, almost painfully unexplosive. Like, who's a freaking athlete?
Anthony Grant. Trey Palmer, probably. Those are our two.
I would say, but on defense, like, who is really a freaky deaky?
Well, our secondary is none.
Reimer, I think... I'm interested to see. I'm actually, like, if, like, Reimer stock right now, I'm probably buying. I think Reimer, I said all along, I've been saying this since January, I thought it was a huge mistake that Nebraska didn't try to do everything they could to get out of that Ireland game. That was a huge mistake, everything that was at stake for them to go to Ireland. Yeah. I think that fucked them up. But I think the going there, the jet lag of that, Reimer getting sick, maybe worse than anybody else, like, Reimer at times has looked explosive to me, but he hasn't looked explosive this year to me.
He's coming off surgeries. I'm not sure where he's at this year. So I think a little bit more time will be good for him. But it's also, like, linebackers will follow the D line. The D line's not playing up to par, especially interior guys. Like, it gets a little bit dicey. I think, you know, between Mathis and Nelson, like, those are our guys that, like, those guys are decently explosive, but not like. They just haven't gotten a chance to shine this year or something, but
I don't know.
We haven't been good. We just have not been good across the board. We've been getting out schemed. We've been getting outplayed. Like, there's a lot that has not gotten right. So it's hard to be like, we're good in any year almost.
So it's weird. I guess to put a bow on the recruiting thing is, like, because people just throw that, like, the next guy's got to be able to recruit. The recruiting issue at Nebraska is real. They got to be able to recruit. And it's like, that's a very loaded, like, Nebraska needs, and this is why dudes like Leipold or Chris Kleiman, like, are interesting in that, like, they strike, again, I call them the HGTV guys. They're builders. They know how to build that foundation. I think they know who they're looking for to get that continuity.
Yeah.
in your program and develop guys and have an eye for talent.
Well, it's funny. I feel like we've missed a lot in like Iowa, Kansas, Missouri. Like you talk about like St. Louis, Kansas City, and then you go like Minneapolis, Wisconsin,
Denver,
Colorado. Yeah. Like we need to do a better job just recruiting there. Like I think it's like a given, like, oh, we get the players we want from around Nebraska. Right. Like we're not even getting those players. Like, so if we can get those players first, then you can recruit Texas, maybe a little bit from California, Florida, Georgia, whatever. But like, you got to just be good in the 500 mile radius.
So maybe that's what Urban's talking about with like how he ended his quote of being like, they have to get someone that understands that area.
Well, yeah, we don't actually do great around Nebraska. Like not right. just, like we got to bat 80 or 90% around Nebraska. And we're just, and this is what where losing hurts you. If you lose, now Iowa is taking those. Because Iowa has a decent, like, they got a million more people than we do.
Yeah.
So they have, you know, if we have four or five recruits worth recruiting every year, they have 10.
Well, and the problem is they've come in and they've taken Noah Fant from Omaha. And yeah. they took Clester Johnson's kid. And they took, you know, like.
That's what I'm saying. We're losing in Omaha.
Right.
Instead of like, okay, Omaha used to be a given. And we used to take Iowa, who we wanted out of Iowa and Missouri, kind of as a given.
Right.
And now it's
a battle.
We're losing Omaha sometimes, and we are struggling to get out of Minnesota, Iowa, Missouri.
Here's the thing, too, that I think is going to be challenging for everybody is the transfer portal is going to make player development. I wonder what that looks like now. Like getting guys to, like, when you came to Nebraska, you probably, I don't know what your expectations were, but I'm sure you were like, I'm gonna come in, I gotta get bigger, stronger, I gotta do, like
3 years seemed reasonable. Like 3-4 years, like I'm gonna wait 3 or 4 years and I can play. Like,
and I just don't reasonable. And I don't think kids think like that now. And
they don't think like
so that. What's hard is like Nebraska probably has to be a developmental program. And I think player development could be challenging in this transfer portal world.
I think it is.
Unless you get the right dudes.
I think the
because what's hard is you don't want to live in a world of like, just give me a bunch of, I'll take a bunch of one stars that want to be here and we'll go kick Ohio State's ass. Like, no, you won't. Okay. No, you won't. Like there is a non-negotiable level of talent that has to be there.
And even the transfer portal, it's like, there's a reason why they're transferring. It's because something is going right there. I mean, a Trey Palmer is like, I think is like, that's a win. That's a win for us.
Right.
Like that's a guy that like,
and that was a rare circumstance. He was sitting behind like first rounders.
And then Nicky comes.
And then his coach gets fired and his receiver coach goes to Nebraska. Like that's a very rare situation. But you find out, I don't mean any offense, like you find out why Devin Drew was in the transfer portal and why Stephon Wynn was in the transfer portal.
They're fine,
they're bodies, they're guys. And I'm not saying like there's a place for guys, but when a guy has to be the man, then you're in trouble.
That's a great one. The guy has to be the man.
And that's the problem is I think maybe this is now.
You a guy? Because you're acting like you're supposed to be the man. No, you're a guy.
You're a guy there. You want to be the man here? That's pretty much what Nebraska was doing, though. They went into the portal like, you're a guy there. You can be a star here. And it's like, I don't know about that.
You want to be a man? I know you're only a guy, but come be a man.
Make here. A man out of you and Lincoln here. You know
that's
what I'm saying, Doug?
Gonna
but that's not going to work. And yeah, you find out like more often than not, dudes are in the portal for a reason.
I think if I have to say there's a saving grace, I really think it's got to be if Nebraska fans and boosters are willing to shell out for
the NIL.
If we're willing to just pay the good guy
right.
players to come here that we can sort of pick, that's going to be our best way to recruit more than I think it's literally like we have to be willing to pay to win. I mean, Nick, I'm serious.
Yeah.
Like right now, I've watched this for 20 years, try to like, this is the model. Let's do it. Like right now, I'm not seeing the organic model more than I am. Like if we're willing to write the check, like that's the fastest way.
I agree.
In a weird way, like we're rarely positioned to do it. Like we kept talking about infrastructure last pod.
Yes.
We have the infrastructure. Like if we're willing to write the check and get the players to win, then we can build on that. But like if we need to win first.
Interesting.
And it's like
interesting. That's an interesting topic. Like you think you need to open up the checkbook before
I want to build organically. I don't want to just write checks for players. I want to build it organically. I'm just saying, like, I've watched this mess it up for 20
years. But a part of me wonders if, like, the messing up for 20 years is, like, it's just been, there's been so much turnover with coaches. There's been a high level of dysfunction in the athletic department. There's been a lot of different athletic directors. There's been a lot of turnover there. There's obviously the change in conferences, which I think is makes a difference as well. Like, and
I'd say this, having Trev Alberts is like
that's what I'm excited about.
It is a great, I don't even know what the word is, but like it's just a great sort of like I don't have the word, but it's like the stability of Trev.
Yes, Alberts, I was just saying stabilizing force.
We've never had that in my. I mean, T.O. came in and did what he had to do, but he was like.
But he always felt like he was like, I'll do it for a year.
I'll do it for two.
I got an appointment. I'm going fishing on Thursday.
I mean, he was retired.
You need me to be on Thursday. Yeah.
He was retired and was not. That was not his goal. He was like,
check with Nancy. Nancy wanted to go. Tell him he's on.
I'll do it. I'll be the athletic director, I guess. All right. I was taking a nap. All right.
No laughing. No Tom Osborne impressions. We love Tom Osborne too much.
He would do it till Thursday. And then he was done.
I'll do it Thursday.
Thursday, I'm going up. I'll be
athletic director through the weekend. Then I got a couple of doctor's appointments.
But like there was this feeling when he showed up. I mean, the dude, you know this, right? Like at the start of that season, Tom Osborne was helping out Creighton basketball. He was meeting with me about leadership, and then he was the athletic director by the end of the year.
And it felt like he was doing it till Thursday.
I'll do it. I'll do it for a week. All right.
Sure. I mean, that is.
Oh, it feels wrong to do an impression of him, but it's.
Dr. Tom.
Oh, my God. Oh, do we refill it? You need to refill.
Refill.
Refill it while we're doing
refill.
That. Quick timeout. Tell you about GoCurrency. Is your business. It's none of my business if your business needs something, but if your business needs something, let me help you out with a little business, okay? You need easy competitive financing for trucks or equipment. Currency is here to help. Currency specializes in finding the best available rates and terms for construction equipment, farm machinery, trucks, and trailers. In fact, customers get loans up to $500,000 with little or no money down in terms of up to 72 months. That's incredible. Currency can also help if you're getting serious about buying a new or used motorhome, fifth wheel, or utility vehicle. Just fill out an application, and the Currency Finance team will get to work finding a lender with the most competitive options. Quick, secure, free to use. Go to currency.com for details. Currency is equipment financing made simple. Offer may vary, arranged by Express Tech Financing, LLC, DBA, Currency Pursuant, CFL, license 60DBO-54873.
I'll do it. I'll do it till Thursday.
I'll use GoCurrency through the weekend.
You want me to? I'll finance it. No money down. That's fine. You got till Thursday.
I like their interest rates.
It feels mean to do that to our guy.
I love Tom.
Okay. I love him. And I tell you, do we need to pitch the university for me and you to teach a history of Husker football class, and we'll just do Husker Classic recaps with people?
Our Husker Classic recap.
It's the best thing that has not gotten is it wrong that I just want like either the Nobel Prize, an Emmy, maybe even a Grammy. Like, I want some recognition, goddammit.
I'll tell you what, that series, I mean, we spent 20 minutes talking about Rick Burns.
Like, yes.
Just running hard in the San Diego.
Jersey.
Like, yeah. I mean, that's the stuff that if Husker fans all need to know.
And it's good because you go watch those games and you're like, yeah, Nebraska was good at one point, you know? Okay.
We so hard.
This was do you care about these last eight games? Oh. Where are you at with that? Where are you at with, because here we go. I mean.
So where am I at with the last eight games? So I needed a week off badly and I got it. So thank goodness. I don't know that I thought a lot about Indiana because it feels like there's so many other things sort of hanging over.
Right.
Just playing the game. Now, what I will say though, is like a win versus Indiana, I think re-engages Husker Nation because
yeah,
really we're 0-1 in the West.
And a look win. Look at you.
Here's what a win does though. A win reminds you that like, oh, we're a competitive team.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean we're winning the West by any means, but like we're back playing football then or something. Like we'll regulate the season. We'll regulate the moment. We've lost two games in a row. One was to a bad team and another was,
you got pounded,
clubbed, right? So I think that if we could win, people will reengage. I think if we lose, Nick, I don't know where we go. If we lose.
I couldn't agree more. That I in some ways, I think this, and we do this, we're such like classic Husker media. It's like the next game's the biggest game of the year. No, by
the Oklahoma game was bigger than this game. I will say the Oklahoma game was bigger.
Yes.
Because Mickey had his, there was like Mickey's moment or something.
Right. But I guess what I'm saying is like if Nebraska goes out and loses this game, there's a chance that the wheels fall off this thing pretty bad. Husker because Nation. Let's be honest, I'm not so sure this isn't the most winnable game left.
This is very winnable. Rutgers should be winnable.
I want to say this is the only game, according to ESPN's FBI, that Nebraska's favored in for the rest of the season.
I wish they wouldn't favor us ever.
I know. I see that. And I'm like favored by 3.5. I'm like, on what planet?
Why? Vegas knows most things. They don't know Nebraska.
No, they've been whiffing on Nebraska for forever now. I don't know.
That's why we've been whiffing on our Nebraska predictions.
Because yeah, I guess we're guilty.
We don't know Nebraska either. That's the thing is we study Nebraska. Vegas studies Nebraska and nobody can predict why it is. The things that are happening to us it's like so freaking mind-numbingly crazy.
I think a couple of things. I guess if do you care about these last eight games? I was way more. Sometimes you don't know how you're going to feel until you get into a moment. Mickey's got a hold on the fans' hearts more than I maybe gave him credit for.
Oh yeah.
Like, oh yeah.
People are rooting for Mickey.
I don't think it's like lip service, you know, like, oh yeah, Mickey, we're cheering for you. And it's like, no,
I'm rooting
like,
for Mickey.
Oh, so am I. Like, I guess. So if there's one thing that is interesting about these last eight games is to see if Mickey can somehow right the ship and be the guy. But here's what's hard. So here's what's hard about that is like, there's a part of me that feels like he's sitting on a losing hand, though. Like with this roster and this team, I'm just not sure if the situation lends itself to like, again, if you brought in Nick Saban and Bill Belichick, I'm not sure this team could win three more games. Based on what I've seen through the first four games.
Based on what I've seen through the first four games, like if our defense could find their footing and play average football, not below average football, our offense, if you besides Oklahoma
win the tank.
I know in Oklahoma we had one drive that we looked like what we were doing. So I still think we forget like our offense has been pretty good for the most part.
Yeah,
we had one really bad game. It's just our defense that has been the disheartening part. Like special teams has been fine. Mm-hmm. But our defense has been just bad. So now it's like if our defense with Bill Bush taking over, maybe a couple of tweaks with who's, I don't know, they've changed starters, but I know they've shuffled.
Some guys. I saw a depth chart. Yeah.
To me, it tells me guys are going to be pushing to get in there if there's issues. So To me, if you get some guys in there that like will play ball, you know, like we'll see, but like,
it's just hard. Like it's the, and this is why I think I framed like, what am I interested in? I tried to manufacture something of what this season could be working for. And that's Mickey being the guy moving forward. The problem is if you remove that, the chance of Mickey being the guy, there feels like this season is a march to nothing, a build towards nothing, because you'd imagine the coaches probably aren't going to be here. A lot of these players might not be here. So if you win or every win or loss feels relatively inconsequential, and nothing will zap your level of wanting to invest more than if something feels inconsequential.
Yeah. So Mickey,
that's the hook to me.
Yeah. To me, it's still in front of us. If Mickey can do it, like, so yes. Mickey can win a couple, because we got 8 games left.
There's 8 games left.
We're a third of the way through the season, so we have 2/3 of the season left. So if Mickey can get on a win streak, I think he needs to win. If he wins 6, I think he has a shot.
Oh yeah,
a shot at being the coach. But I don't think
he would go 5-3 in the final 8 games. If homeboy goes 5-3 in these final 8 games, he's the head coach.
No, I think 5.
He is. Nebraska is their last 5 games. They are losing all of those games. Minnesota is going to dismantle Nebraska. Michigan is going to dismantle.
Michigan will beat us.
Nebraska. Did you watch Minnesota, what they did to Michigan State?
No,
I didn't. Oh, Lord. I mean, Flex got a squad.
Yeah.
And then I just don't see them winning at Iowa, and I don't see them beating Wisconsin. Although Wisconsin didn't look great this weekend. But the problem is, like, you know, Indiana's not great. Rutgers isn't great. Like,
but are they better than Georgia Southern and North Dakota and Northwestern? Maybe.
I don't know. They are.
And that's the problem, is like, we don't know how to win games.
Well, the problem is Northwestern might be like atrociously bad. I mean, Northwestern's got 1 win and it's against Nebraska. They lost again this weekend to Southern Illinois. So it's like, we can sit here, they lose to Miami of Ohio and they lost to Southern Illinois 31-24. If they get to 6 wins, I mean, realistic number of wins left out there. To me, it's these next 2 weeks. Like, you got to win these next 2 games.
I think if they can win the next 2, people will at least be, I think, engaged for the rest of the season. I think the hard part is if they lose the next 2 and then you go, oh, Minnesota, Michigan. Like, it's just like,
I know. So that's what I'm saying. Like, I think the players would feel like that, and the coaches maybe start feeling like that. Everyone, like, you need to dangle that carrot of Mickey continuing to maybe being the guy to keep everyone engaged, fans, players, everybody. Keep them locked in. And to me, that the only way that happens is if you win this weekend.
You got to win.
If Nebraska goes out and loses to Indiana, it is, I don't want to sit here and say it is just like it, the season's just, it's over. But I just have a hard time envisioning them losing to Indiana at home and then somehow making anything out of these last 7 games.
I think it's just very crucial, because I think if we do win, I think the fans will get, like, everybody will get a, not a little confidence boost, but like a big confidence. I think the players will get a big confidence boost. Like, I think with changes sometimes, like, if you make a big change and you see something good happen, like, okay, we have a new coordinator in, and then it works, people believe pretty quick, and our players will believe pretty quick.
Oh yeah.
Like, sometimes they'll go like, maybe this was what the problem was. And it wasn't that we can't tackle. Right.
Right.
So,
you're right. Like, because I think there is a potential opportunity here with, okay, you got Frost is gone. Chenander's gone. You had a bye week. You had this opportunity. The bye week probably let everybody catch their breath.
Yeah.
And if they would go out and play well, that would be an enormous shot of belief from the players on, like, all the changes, like, well, Mickey's in charge now, and Bush is now with this defensive, Bush is running, like, this is what's happening. Like, but it, to me, it's, and I don't want to make anything, I mean, you try to make Indiana, Nebraska the Super Bowl, but it feels like if this game is, it's shapes the season.
It's the Super Bowl for Nebraska fan engagement and player engagement.
Maybe that's the best way to put it, because Trev did announce that the game is a sellout, so sellout streak is going to extend for another week, which we talked about last week. That is a good thing.
I am a supporter.
But you're right. Like, it's the Super Bowl for fan engagement. If you lose this game, it is hard to imagine a lot of excitement around here for the final seven games. And if you lose this game, you just wonder where the players' confidence level is going to be at. And it just, all those things get dramatically more challenging to stay engaged as a fan, to stay excited and confident as a player.
Yeah.
But you're right. I mean, there's still eight. There's not three games left. There's eight games left.
And as a player, too, like, this is where the argument for, like, making changes with coaches. If you've lost three of your first four, and the coaches are the same. Like, I've been through that. And, like, I mean,
no, 7,
we were losing.
Right.
And it got halfway through the season, and there was no changes made. And you're looking ahead going, like, this is bad. And it's only going to get, you just, that's as a bad of feeling. It's almost a better feeling. These kids is like, well, we got new guys running the show. It's almost refreshes. So I think there's an argument for this in the sense of, like, it's a refreshing for the kids. Like, this is new. Here's the new strategy.
Right. And I think people need to understand from a player's perspective too, everything that happens day to day is reinforcing what we do. You know what I mean? It's like, our way of doing things. And you're like, just, it gets, I'd imagine in 07, it probably got pretty hard for the coaches to get up there and try to preach to you to, like, stay the course with, like, the plan when the plan had not worked at all, you know? Yeah, and
it was,
so you switch it up, you give these guys a different opportunity to think about something else. Like, that was interesting last week with you, I didn't think about it from that perspective from a player's perspective on trying to give them a new view or zest, like, you just get, like, a new lease on, like, the season
you get to start over. And sometimes you need that, where if the old voice was in the old way of doing things was falling flat, it's hard to just be like, and we're going to try it again. Like, they've done that for 5 years. Like, they did it for 5 years, and now at least we're going to try something new. Like, if we go down, we're going to go down not just, like, playing the same songs, like,
right,
like, keep on rocking in the free world.
That's what was happening.
We're gonna play a new song,
right?
And we're gonna see if this is the one that works.
What? Okay, the one thing I got to pull up what these stats were.
I don't know why I went with "Keep on Rocking."
I like that you did that.
What's the song? Because that's not an annoying song. What's, like, an annoying song?
Well, my Nick Boss sneaky most hated song in the world, "Money Money."
Here she come down.
I don't know why.
Money, money.
That song kills me. "Love Shack" rubs me the wrong way.
Oh God.
"Love Shack" rubs me the wrong way. "Money Money" rubs me the wrong way. Those are probably my top two. Those are kind of sneaky played at, like, weddings a lot too. And you're just like, oh God. Is there anything worse than when you're on the dance floor and a song comes on and you're like,
what? I have a beef with wedding DJs because you can't tell me if you're a professional, you do this for a living, and you decide, all right, we just had three great songs, and now it's time for "Money Money." That's not intentional. You don't want to ruin our night.
Like, are you trying to pace people? Like, you're trying to keep them hydrated, or, like, keep that, like,
is it like a secret code? Like, we gotta get these guys off the floor.
Now's the time. Okay, we gotta get them off the floor. It's "Love Shack" in here.
"Love Shack," "Money Money." Let's go.
Let's go. "Love Shack," "Money Money." We'll get them off the floor for a little bit.
Let's get them out. They need to go drink. We want them to get, the bartender's paying me
seriously
to get tips. So let's get them over the drink.
I just do not, like, is there anything worse than that feeling when you're on the dance floor and the song that's played is just like, no, I am not.
So you've always been, least favorite songs, "Money Money." What's Bear's?
I don't know.
I'm trying to remember his. Do you remember mine?
No.
I don't like summer nights. Like
the Grease song? Tell me.
Tell me more. Yeah, tell me more.
That's bad.
I don't like that song.
That song's bad.
Sounds annoying.
Yeah, that's bad. You know what song is sneaky, like I used to love, that now is like, be honest, if Usher Yeah comes on, I'm a little like, I need like a 5 year, like we need to put that song in a lockbox for 5 years. And then like archaeologists need to find it.
What is this? Lil Jon Usher Ludacris. Yeah, we play it now for everybody to have party.
Like then that would be great.
The only reason I like it,
it's of the songs that are overplayed, it's a song I can kind of get going. Hear it
for the only reason I like it is my wife's dad. So my father-in-law. Yep.
That's his track.
Well, he doesn't know any rap songs. He's a New Zealander, right? So he's from
right.
He's a dairy farmer by trade from New Zealand, and he loves Yeah because they say. And Ludacris says, and I milk the cow. He loves it because
simply because of that. It applied to his life.
He says, I milked
the cow. It applied to his life.
So he likes it and he dances at weddings. So as much as I'm with you, I give it a pass right now because he likes it and he'll dance to it. But he likes the part where they say
the milk the cow. I respect the cow.
Where are we at? Dairy farmer.
Where I like that. I respect that. Now I feel bad. I even ripped on the song. But
no. But it's
where are we at with the Cupid Shuffle and the wobble?
I think I'll cube as much as this is embarrassing. I'll Cupid Shuffle before I wobble. I'm not a wobbler.
Yeah, I think by the end of just next time machine, everybody on the dance floor wobble. By the end of the wobble, everybody's so half-heartedly wobbling.
I know.
That's the problem. It's like dance is about expression. Like those songs, like it's hard to add your own thing to them. My daughter loves the Cupid Shuffle because she knows left and right, and like so Mava loves it. So that reinvigorated my love for the Cupid Shuffle, but I've been pretty anti the Cupid Shuffle.
Because there's Cupid Shuffle. What's the other one that's like
Wobble? The
no, there's another one too. There's what did Martin Lawrence call the ghetto hokey pokey?
I thought it was yeah, what did he call the ghetto hokey pokey? It's not the Cupid Shuffle?
Take it back them time.
Oh,
turn yeah, around.
Yes. Oh my God, that's this is saying. Embarrassing.
Martin
on a
Lawrence called yeah. the ghetto. He goes, yeah. That's the ghetto hokey pokey.
Can you go
pokey.
Down low?
Yeah.
How low can you go? What is that song?
I'm blanking on it right now. But that one might be worse than. So Cupid's probably better than that.
Oh God, that's going to kill me for the rest of the show that I can't think of that song. But yeah, that's another one.
Martin Lawrence called the ghetto hokey
yeah.
pokey. I know the ghetto hokey pokey.
Two stomps this time. Yeah. Coom, coom. What is that song?
Turn around.
Everybody clap your hands. It's like, oh, this is everybody. But me and you want songs you can just, you know, you really can get, you get the hips in it. If it's not moving my hips, it don't exist. You know what I'm saying?
To have hard beats.
Oh, God. Okay, how did we get out of that?
Bad wedding songs.
I don't know how we got onto that though. I'm not sure how we got onto that.
I can't remember.
Oh, I know. I wanted to ask you this. This is no way to transition into this. Indiana, number one in the country in plays per minute. As Mickey said, they're third fastest in the country in snapping the ball. So they play fast. Ooh. He talked about that. You know, the key for that is to get like the calls in quick.
Yep.
You had to deal with a lot of up-tempo offenses. Now, things have gone, like, even more so now. What's the key? Well, to lay it out for us in twofold. What's the key to stopping an up-tempo offense? And then take us into the mind. You're a linebacker. They just got a five-yard gain on first down, and all of a sudden you're getting up and you're having to get lined up. And because Mickey talked about, like, you got to be able to, like, it's like one-word calls. Like, yeah. You're getting the front, the cover it, like.
I mean, I feel like when I
give me a chalk talk here.
Well, this is I'm gonna be a dated chalk talk because I mean this is like
we did the wing tee.
We're playing Oklahoma 78. We're gonna run a fullback dive. That's slam down.
Where's Rick Burns?
If they want to play fast, Rick we're Burns. Gonna hand the ball. Jeff McVick.
Rick Burns, I think we're pretty
good. Chances of them playing fast.
We play well.
If Jeff
we have McVick. A chance at winning, if we give ball Rick Burns.
Why are we doing two others?
Slow down.
Go way too fast. Okay, sorry.
I'm just thinking, I mean, like, my day might not apply totally to this because it was the beginning.
What's sad stages. Is, like, our day is getting, like, to where it was, like,
I'm saying it's getting closer.
A long years. Time ago. We're, like, it's back 15. In my day. Let me tell you.
I mean, that was when it was, like.
You ever seen a shotgun formation? Let me tell you. We saw one team run the shotgun in high school, Central. Courtney Grigsby took a shotgun snap and, like, it was, like, a QB sweep. It was like,
they didn't know how to do it,
though. Yeah, but it was, like, damn, dog. They got in the shotgun. Okay, so. What now?
But anyway, so like that was when like Texas Tech first went like true spread. Mike Leach, true spread. Chase Daniel in Missouri.
Yep.
Mangino at Kansas. Okie State went spread. Oklahoma finally went spread. So we were seeing a lot of the spread.
You got spread, boy.
Tons of spread. But I don't know that we ever saw like the pace quite like Oregon did. I mean, Texas Tech went fast. But you kind of had to have like, your base calls and you just had to know your checks. It was hard to run. Here's the hard part, which I'm be very curious to see. When people go that fast to call blitzes and pressures, right?
Yeah.
So blitzes are basically six or more. Pressures are usually like an even amount, right? Like
yep.
It's like a five man call, right? So, I don't know. I don't know how they do that against the like super speed because most of the time, but the trade-off though is like if they're going that fast, they're not thinking through like this is what they're like.
Right, they're running pretty vanilla stuff too. Yeah,
they
right?
have a couple of calls that they're kind of probably doing a read off of.
Yep.
And so you just got to know that hey, it's going to be a handful of plays,
right?
Probably with run pass options on each, and you got to kind of have a good feel for what those are. And take those away and make them do something else.
It'll be interesting though. Like it's unfortunate for Bill Bush. The first game he's calling the plays that you're dealing with things that, I mean, you saw how fast Oklahoma was going.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't got time to call anything.
But you're better off getting it in early. To me, it's all about like, I'd rather have something in that, you know, is like, this isn't a perfect defense, but it's in. We're ready to go. Then trying to call the perfect play at the last second, and we're not lined up, and we're not prepared each snap.
Give me a sense, and people listening at home got to be as novice as I am. Like calling the plays on defense, what is that even like? Calling the plays on offense is a very understandable thing.
Yeah.
Can you like? Give us like the explain in the words of Michael Scott, explain it to me like I'm a 5-year-old. Okay. If you had to explain calling the plays defensively to dumb it down and it's
you study the film of what do they do, and then you chart out first down, second down, third down. You chart out situations. This is what they do in this personnel. So it's a lot of it's personnel based,
okay.
Right? They run, let's say they have 11 personnel trips and it's, you've charted, it's 90% pass. You're probably going to call your defense. If it's like, if they come out in 11 personnel, okay, here's our call. And if it's trips, this is the check. But like, you know, like you might, that's my, the way you might call out a game. It's like it's based on their tendencies with calls and checks, right? So sometimes you'll double call. You'll call two things, right? You call it so, hey, if they come out and if it's 21, but they come out in slot, there's a check with slot, right?
Okay.
So that makes sense?
Yeah.
Like slot is like
yeah.
two receivers on one yeah. side, yeah. tight end over here, right? Like so there's things change based on formation, but you'll have a call based on basically the personnel. Like if it's 11, which is one tight end, one running back. 12 is one running back, two tight ends.
So there's just different, there's different personnel groupings, and you'll call or double call, and you'll have your checks based on their tendencies. I mean, that's basically the game. And like pressures are, that's like what the coordinator, that's it. That's it. That's a gut call thing, right? Like,
right.
And so I, you know, that's the game.
It'd be, I mean, it's just, it's, I am very excited to see, like, do you think we'll see a discernible difference in how the defense looks and operates?
I would think a little bit. I mean, they're going to try to use the same terminology, but they're going to mix it up a little bit. I don't know how much they're going to mix it up, but probably I would think more. They're going to do some things differently, right? Probably a little bit more. I'd guess they'd simplify some things. They're going to simplify some calls and just say, let's play.
Right.
Let's just make it clear and let's play.
I don't know.
And I think that's the way to go. I mean, in the end, it's like, let's make things clear. And
oh, yeah. I mean, I think when you hit a general rule of thumb, regardless of sport, like if you hit making simplifying is the way to go over like adding more things. They do not need more things to think of. They need to simplify things.
Yeah.
And I get the sense that's what they're doing.
I think they're trying to.
But I also think this game lends itself to that because I don't think you can overdo when a team's playing so fast defensively. There's not a lot you can do.
When they're going so fast, you just got to make it. You got to have a call ready and go and like you just be ready to play.
The other thing, Mickey talked about they're potentially going to slow it down on offense a little bit to help out the defense.
Well, they were supposed to against Oklahoma and didn't do it.
Right.
You know, that's the part of like saying it and then doing it. Like, the plan is let's slow it. Like, and then it's like when you actually get in the game and
right.
You have to like uncomfortably slow the game down. Like, and that's where I'll give PJ Fleck when they played us and they were snapping it with like a second on the clock.
I love it.
Every play
I love him.
For an entire game. And you're just like,
I love it.
There was no way we should have lost that game to Minnesota. And we did. They half their team had COVID and they
snapped it with 2 seconds or 1 second on the clock the entire game.
It was in such an impressive feat of time management.
It was amazing.
I loved it in a way it was hard to describe. But
why do I like all of the things about football that are boring?
Because
I like
it's punting. Strategy.
I like
it's
time strategy. Of possession. I like defense. I like running the ball in like eye formations.
If you like that, it means you've gotten old. But it is because with your age, you've gotten wiser. And you know that when you aren't the best team, those are the things you have to do to win. When you're not the best team, you must control the clock. You must muck up the game. And you must make it ugly and give yourself the opportunities.
Do you think Nebraska is going to win this game?
Yeah.
I have no, I like,
I don't know.
I didn't even, this is the first game. I wrote down prediction ... and I didn't even finish it because I don't know.
Nick, Vegas doesn't know. We don't know.
Right. I wouldn't favor Nebraska.
No, I wouldn't either. I don't know what we're going to come out. Like what kind of gusto we're going to come out with.
I like that gusto.
That gusto.
I like that.
Cause we need gusto.
Yeah, they need a lot of gusto.
We need our defense to play. If our defense plays, our offense will follow. I think we're going to see, like, if our defense comes out and like, oh, the first three drives,
see that
Indiana scores three touchdowns. Like it's going to be a long year.
That's what it feels like. The first, I feel like I've said this for a decade straight. It feels like that first 10 minutes of the game, Nebraska needs to deliver the first punt. If they get punched in the mouth first, not good.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I feel like, honestly, if I had to say gun to my head, I'd pick Indiana to win the game.
I hate picking against Nebraska.
So do I, but it's like, I just don't know. Based on what I've seen, it's hard to have much confidence in this team to win.
Nebraska's offense needs to think differently. We need to think about like, okay, where's our weakness right now? We're struggling on defense. So what do? Well, obviously scoring a lot of points is great.
Right.
But you know what's better? Running the ball a lot.
Yeah.
And having like,
see, but the problem is, I think Whipple's like wanting to whip that thing around.
Should we play?
He wants to whip. I mean, he might need to whip that thing. But hey, how about the fact our boy Gabe Irvin gonna be getting some burn?
Why do
now?
We love Gabe Irvin so
because Gabe Irvin. I am here on behalf of Gabe Irvin and the trials and tribulations of
Ladies
Gabe Irvin.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me present Evidence A, Gabe Irvin falsely accused of not being a good running back.
Seriously.
His line didn't block.
Ladies and gentlemen, the general, I think we're going to pull up the Fordham game. This is the first possession that I would like the jury to note the starting point inside the 10-yard line. Your options are very limited. Roll the tape. You see very disruptive tackle for loss. Very not allowed you to do.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, let me point to Exhibit B, Oklahoma's field. Clearly, poorly taken care of. Gabe Irvin tears his knee. His season was just about to explode. I rest my case.
If you and I got to Saul Goodman and Kim Wexler defend Gabe Irvin in the court of the state of Nebraska's opinion versus Gabe Irvin, I would violently defend Gabe Irvin.
I am defending Gabe Irvin. I mean, nobody's gotten a worse to rap. Run.
I think Gabe Irvin, I want a handful of things. I want Gabe Irvin to ball out. I want our guy, Chancellor Brewington V, to come in and, you know.
He's going to tap into the trust fund to dig a little deeper. And make a couple crackback blocks and maybe a quick touchdown catch.
I want more Brewington in my life. I want more Brewington in my life. I do want more Vokalek. Vokalek went overseas, hurt the ankle.
He got special treatment.
He got special Guinness infusion in Dublin.
Smirnoff.
No, but I need vodka. They give me Guinness.
Yes.
Yada, yada, yada. I don't play.
We just got Seinfeld. Have
you seen this guy, Jerry Seinfeld? He talked to Kramer and yada, yada.
In Minsk, and in Minsk, we just got Seinfeld. Hilarious.
I watch episode. I master of my domain because I not touch Elaine. Little Vokalek. I do not want
Elaine, not master of her domain. She got
Elaine
dumber.
Was done.
She was dumber with no master.
I want
great show.
I want. I'm Travis Vokalek. I review Seinfeld episodes 30 years after fact. Okay.
Kenny Roger Roaster.
Can you believe chicken shop open and Kramer lose mind over chicken?
Jerry walks in acting like Kramer. Hilarious. Hilarious.
So we're rooting for Vokalek to review Seinfeld episodes. We're rooting for Gabe Irvin. We're going to Saul Goodman, Gabe Irvin all the way to the top.
I will defend.
And then we want Chancellor Brewington to tap into the trust fund.
Of course.
I want more. So is that too much to ask? What else we want in our life?
We want.
What else are you looking for in your life these days?
We want Reimer to go to the pool and make a splash. Oh, Nick, don't hurt your stitches. Don't hurt your stitches. I'm sorry.
Why did you do that? Lord have mercy on my soul, dog.
Nicholas, this always happens. We get to the end of the bottle.
We went to France.
No, we went to Italy.
Oh, we went to Italy, didn't we? Why do I always do that?
Because you always do it wrong. It's great.
I went to Hastings. Nancy took my Hastings.
I went to Hastings.
You want to listen to some? Wrap it up. What do you want to listen to, dog? You want to whip it or you want to Tom Jones?
We either got to whip it or we got to give him the moany moany.
We're going to moany moany it?
No, in honor of.
Can I give you the song that I wanted to play just because it's good?
Yes. Surprise me. Don't tell me. Don't
okay,
tell me.
This is the song. I was literally had no angle other than how is this song not better or not more widely acclaimed? Are you ready as we're going to wrap this thing up? This song goes out to a special someone, Gabe Irvin, Travis Vokalek, and Chancellor Brewington. This one's for you. I mean, dog. How is this song not bigger? How, come on.
Is this the Brothers Johnson?
This is Frankie Beverlina Mays. Before I let you go,
Frankie.
I mean, why is this song not played at the weddings?
Because those DJs are in cahoots with the bartenders.
They must be. Mr. and Mrs. Johnson have cut the cake. You know what time it is.
And I really love you. You should know.
Why is this song not bigger and better? Like, it's 1981. Before I let you go.
Before I let you go.
I mean, come on now. This is a good song to wrap it up to. The credits are rolling on the screen right now. Anything you want to say to the people before we say goodbye? You want to play it? No. We can't turn this into, have you heard this song before? Have you seen it? Have you heard about this?
No, we better not.
Time out of burning presents?
I think we better.
Do we need to wrap it up?
Let's wrap it up before
Thursday. 1981, I'd beaten Oklahoma. So I just want to say that.
Rick Burns.
Rick Burns, I love you.
We'll see you next week.
See ya.